to add some detail to something that you touched on lightly. According to Wikipedia, James Baldwin's Wikipedia page, it says at the time of Baldwin's death, he had an unfinished manuscript called Remember This House, which Michelle referenced early in her comments, a memoir of his personal recollections of civil rights leaders, Medgar Evers, Malcolm X, Martin Luther King Jr., as Michelle spoke about. Here's an interesting piece of detail. Following his death, publishing company McGraw-Hill took the unprecedented step of suing his estate to recover the $200,000 advance they had paid him for the book, although the lawsuit was dropped by 1990. Interesting. So they were trying to get their money back from this book that he didn't finish because he died. And 30 years later, James Baldwin died on December 1st, 1987. 30 years after his death, this piece, I Am Not Your Negro, from this unfinished manuscript, Remember This House, is now resurrected, which I think is a beautiful thing. Another thing I would like to say is I haven't seen the film yet, but I'm familiar with all of the conversations you mentioned with Buckley and all of that, just from my extensive study of James Baldwin and perusing and collecting all of the clips that are available on YouTube now. I don't know if Raoul Peck took this title from this conversation that I'm about to reference, but I am familiar with the conversation of James Baldwin saying, I am not your nigger.
Well, I know this, and anyone who's ever tried to live knows this. So what you say about somebody else, you know, anybody else, reveals you. What I think of you as being is dictated by my own necessities, my own psychology, my own fears and desires. I'm not describing you when I talk about you. I'm describing me. Now here in this country, we've got something called a nigger. It doesn't in such terms, I beg you to remark, exist in any other country in the world. We have invented the nigger. I didn't invent him. White people invented him. I've always known, I had to know by the time I was 17 years old, what you were describing was not me, and what you were afraid of was not me. It had to be something else. You had invented it, so it had to be something you were afraid of. You invested me with. Now that's so. No matter what you've done to me, I can say to you this, and I mean it. I know you can't do any more, and I got nothing to lose. And I know, and I've always known, you know, and really always, that's part of the agony. I've always known that I'm not a nigger. But if I am not the nigger, and if it's true that your invention reveals you, then who is the nigger? I am not the victim here. I know one thing from another. I know I'm going to be born and I'm going to be, you know, I was born, I'm going to suffer and I'm going to die. And the only way you get through a life is to know the worst things about it. I know that a person is more important than anything else. Anything else. I learned this because I've had to learn it. But you still think, I gather, that the nigger is necessary. Well, it's unnecessary to me, so it must be necessary to you. And I give you your problem back. You're the nigger, baby. It isn't me.
It wasn't Negro. It was I am not your nigger. Mm-hmm. And he was said, the question is, if you call me nigger, then you must need a nigger. And what you need to ask yourself, white people, is why you need a nigger. So I don't know if I am not your Negro is a softer version of this particular conversation. I would love to ask Raoul Peck that question. Mm-hmm. But I am familiar with I am not your nigger. And it does raise the question, why do white people and did white people and do white people need a nigger? What is that in the white psyche that requires a nigger? It's like when I was a child, for whatever my reasons were, I've talked about this before, but I had a little stuffed animal and I carried that thing everywhere. I went to bed with it every night. I needed that. It was like Linus in his security blanket. And the thing had, it got so tattered. The eye came off. My mom would sew it back on. The arm came off. She would sew it back on. It got to the point where I was growing up and they were like, we have got to divorce this boy from this doll or teddy bear. that when I went to sleep one night, they took it from me. I thought I lost it. I couldn't find it. But that actually, they had taken it from me. And they went along with me thinking that I had lost it. And they got rid of it because they just thought, he's too old for this. He can't be relying on this as a crutch. And so why did I need that? I don't know why my little mind needed that. I can't connect with that young boy. But for some reason, I needed that doll. So if I'm a nigga to white folks, why do they need that? And that's tapping inside the white psyche to understand why they required a nigga. Let me just say, history would tell me, Baldwin brought it up in this piece that I read somewhat, white women needed a mammy. White masters certainly needed slaves. So they needed niggas to till their fields, to produce their crops, to raise their children. They needed niggas. Why? What is that in the white mind that says, I can't go out and pick my own cotton? I can't go out and raise my own crops. I can't even be bothered to pull out my tit and nurse my own child. What is that in the white psyche? And whatever that is, we don't have it as black folks. And they know we don't have that. We don't have that. And they know we don't have it. And part of the hatred for black folks is because they look at us and recognize that we have something that they don't have. We don't have that. Now, when I say we don't have that, of course, there are some who will say, wait a minute, brother, look at some of the African countries. They treat each other just as badly as we do. I'm thinking of Rwanda and all the ethnic cleansing. That is true. That's another spirit. And I understand that. But that's not what I'm talking about in the history of American slavery.
Of America.
Right.
Yeah, I get exactly what you're saying, because you're speaking specifically about the history of American slavery.
Exactly.
See, I would go to even further than that and recognize that it is a part of the, I believe, this can be disputed, but I believe it is a part of the human psyche and human nature to always put someone beneath you. And collectively, when you have people in power, it is always necessary for them to have some other people that are not as good as them. And that's a bigger conversation, because I honestly believe that it's just a part of human nature.
Okay, now I wouldn't dispute that. I'm thinking, as soon as you said that, my mind went to a wolf pack or a lion pride. Okay.
Exactly.
Okay. Now, and the male lions will fight each other for control of the pride. All right. And that is about power, as you say. But it's not to demean the other male lions. It's to protect the pride. Okay. It's not for the sake of just humiliating a lion, because once it's determined that I lead the pride, everybody else falls in line. There's a distinction from that and what we see in American slavery. And that mindset of American slavery was not just to control the people, but to completely diminish them, to rape the women and sell off the babies. I mean, that is a whole different level of disease and dysfunction that is not a natural part of the animal kingdom, I would argue.
And I love the fact that you brought that up, because I think that that is amazing. And what's really the contradiction is that what makes us different from the animal kingdom is supposedly this thing called rationale.
Exactly.
The ability to think further and have complex thinking.
Exactly.
And so is it to be said that man with all this complex thinking can only think of doing harm to the next man? Because let's talk about I thought you were going to go to the wolf pack, because let's talk about the wolf pack, where within that pack they have an omega.
Mm-hmm.
And the omega is at the bottom of the rank. But you know what? They're not running off killing that omega.
Exactly.
That omega is still a part.
Exactly.
You've got your alpha dogs, you've got your alpha female, but you've got this pack, but that omega's like, he knows he's at the bottom, and sometimes he has to roll over and show his belly and show a little, you know, like, hey, mama, I know you're powerful, I know who you are, but they're not killing him.
Exactly.
They're not raping him. They're not selling them off to, you know, another pack.
Exactly.
And so that has always been the question. As I travel through the world sometimes and go back in history, and I think I've brought this up before, when you're like in places like Egypt and you're in places that are thousands of years old, and you realize that the language of man has always been, or one of the words and or actions of man has always been war. It makes you think about, really, is this just a part of who we are? And if it is, how are we going to correct it, and how are we going to deal with it?
Power and control. Several shows ago, we talked about the colonization of America. And one of the points that you had made, Michelle, was the fact that, you know, don't get it twisted. It wasn't like rich people were coming over here to the colonization of the world. It was basically
they were basically looked upon as the lesser in their society, whether it was in Britain and when they colonized in Holland or in the Dutch area. And so the opportunity to come over to the United States, yes, okay, quote, for religious freedom, but basically so they would no longer be at the bottom of the ring, so they can basically be in charge. So now you come over here to this new world, and so there's no one to, quote, dominate or to be controlled over, so rather to dominate someone themselves than to bring someone else over so where they can dominate and to diminish so they can create another hierarchical system. So
absolutely.
Nobody, so when you have been at the bottom for so long, now you go someplace, okay, now it's just me. I want to feel like I have some kind of control of authority. So that is a void within our psyche concerning the feeling like we have to dominate and be in control of someone. When the Europeans came over here, the Native Americans who were already over here, they wanted to dominate because they felt like
that's
you
right.
are not my equal. So there's
that's
something
right.
within us that's trying to always dominate and to be in control, and there's always various different reasons. It's because what you have, I want, and I feel like I desire it, or I feel threatened. So therefore, let me control you. Otherwise, you are going to overtake me. So it's, in their mind, it's self-preservation. So different scenarios motivate the domination, but it doesn't change the fact that it's there to maintain control and authority.
Yes, I understand Michelle's point about war, and I understand, Dante, your point about domination. I do. I get it. In the context of American slavery, which is what I know as an American, and then I would like us to segue after we get to the end of our thoughts with this. And we did have a civil war to end slavery and all of that. I get the human components and the animal components of warring prides and warring packs and warring nations. I understand that. I'm not going to use a current popular word, normalize the dehumanization and demonization of black people at the hands of white people that happened during slavery. That is a different thing. From control and domination. There's another level here that is not pretty at all. And that's a sickness. That is more than protecting your neighborhood from outsiders who would do harm to the women and children. When you get up, and Baldwin spoke to this in that piece, when you get up out of your bed, slave master, from your wife, and go down to the slave quarters and take a black woman out of her bed with her husband and rape her and send her back to her husband, have her birth that baby, knowing that it's yours, and in some cases sell the child off so you don't have to look at your sins, and I'm using that word sins loosely in quotes, because a baby is not a sin, but you understand what I'm saying. There's something operating in the white psyche there that is sick. That's a sickness, and that's what led Malcolm and the Nation of Islam to characterize the white devil.
I'm speaking as a black man from America, which is a racist society. No matter how much you hear it talk about democracy, it's as racist as South Africa, or as racist as Portugal, or as racist as any other racialist society on this earth. The only difference between it and South Africa preaches separation and practices separation. America preaches integration and practices segregation. This is the only difference. They don't practice what they preach. Whereas South Africa preaches and practices the same thing. I have more respect for a man who lets me know where he stands, even if he's wrong, than the one who comes up like an angel and is nothing but a devil.
That's what they mean when they say that. Because there's a level of sickness here that you don't see us with that. We don't have that in the context of American slavery.
Right.
So when we talk about what it means to be an American, I recognize myself as an American black man as having a component in my character that is not present in the white man's character who did some of the things to black folks that we've never done in return to white people. So much so that when we see a black man today be accused or even commit sex crime against a white woman, this is the thing that irks white society and white men in particular the most. And this is what has always frightened them the most. That's why they didn't even want a brother to look at a white woman. Because in their psyche, they know what they have done to black women generation after generation after generation. And if that quote unquote boy had half the impulses that they've acted on, that was terrifying to them. Terrifying to them. It's a sickness. Racism is a cancer and a sickness that white people have that they need to cleanse themselves of. And what we're seeing today is a resurgence of a cancer that never really went away, but just calmed itself beneath the surface for a time.
Right.
It's a spiritual sickness.
And it's a spiritual
spiritual sickness. There isn't even a word for the things that we have seen man do to other men, mm-hmm. and a man do to man.
Here's what Wikipedia says about James Baldwin. James Baldwin's FBI file contains 1,884 pages of documents collected from 1960 until the early 70s. During that era of illegal surveillance of American writers, the FBI accumulated 276 pages on Richard Wright, 110 pages on Truman Capote, and just 9 pages on Henry Miller, who was also an American writer, white, I might add. And so I would just refer our brothers and sisters who are listening to COINTELPRO, if you've never heard that word before. All capital letters, COINTELPRO, COINTELPRO, which was a secret CIA surveillance program, illegal, I might add, of American citizens. Research that. And for black folks, we have always been keenly aware that we're being watched. We're being watched.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
We're being watched. Mm-hmm. And James Baldwin mm-hmm. was certainly watched. 1,884 pages of documents?
Can you imagine that?
Come on now.
Because for a period of time, it reminds me, there is a clip in the movie where the FBI, I'm trying to remember, what's his name?
Hoover.
Hoover says that Baldwin seems to be the intricate voice of the black man and that he has to be watched. I'm paraphrasing, but oh yeah, they were like after him because he was the writer who came and decided that he was going to be a participant in writing and voicing this story. And he wasn't the same person who came from the hood. He was the gentleman who was respected in France. I mean, think about this. 1965? When you see this footage and you see that he is speaking to a room of probably 100 people of white students and leaders at Cambridge University in 1965, and when he stopped, they applaud.
Mm-hmm.
This man had power.
Yeah, see, it's one thing.
And he had a power of his word and his voice.
That's right. It's one thing to, I'm speaking, which is tricky, but as he said in that piece I read earlier, black folks know white folks because we've had to study them just to matriculate through society. They don't really have to know us, but we got to know them. And it's one
right.
thing from the white perspective, if you just a nigga from the hood and you don't really know nothing except the hood and whatever that limited view of the world is, you're not a threat to white people. They'll leave you alone. But once Baldwin went to Europe and had lived in France and had an international perspective and could bring that back to the hood, once Malcolm made the Hajj to Mecca and came back and had evolved from the Nation of Islam's worldview, that's what got him killed. That's when these pages were created. Because, he ain't just a nigga from Brooklyn anymore living in a tenement. We can deal with that. He's got a world view. He knows how the world works. And he's able to bring that global influence back to his people and all people.
And right.
Martin Luther King going to India.
Exactly.
Gandhi coming back, nonviolent. So it speaks to what you talked about, Robert, about being awoke. When you go in, and Michelle talking about knowledge, education. When we get in power, understanding our voice, and we bring that to the masses, because when you speak to a people that's been very downtrodden, don't know nothing, don't care, and you invigorate and you empower, that is a threat, because then now you are trying to, you're stirring up something where is okay, we are now being threatened where we can lose control because it would be no longer do as I say. Now I'm questioning you why. What you're doing does not make sense because previously I didn't know any better.
Right. Mm-hmm. Now Dante, before we segue over to you, which we're going to do almost right now, one more thing I want to say. It fascinates me as I listen to Michelle talk about the film and as I read these Wikipedia pages and as I was watching a piece that I put on my Facebook page, I really encourage people to watch it. It was an American Masters documentary on Maya Angelou called And Still I Rise. It premiered on PBS earlier this week, and after the premiere, they've made it available on pbs.org for free streaming. Would really encourage you to watch it. There are a few stories and details in there that I had never heard about Maya Angelou's life. It fascinates me the relationships, who knew who back when, and the lifelong friendships. So when you talk about Michelle,
right.
It does. Isn't it fascinating? When you talk about that James Baldwin was good friends with Medgar Evers and Martin Luther King and Malcolm X. And in this piece, I did not know that Maya Angelou and Cicely Tyson were lifelong friends.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't know that.
Really? Oh, yeah.
No, I didn't know that. And all of my reading of her life and studying of her work, that is a tidbit that never rose to the top of my consciousness. And Cicely Tyson tells this story in that documentary. Now, Cicely Tyson is like 91 now, and this piece was just completed earlier this year, or late last year. So she was, let's say, 90 when she's given this story. And she said toward the end of Maya's life, of course, she was in a wheelchair. Maya Angelou also said that she suffered from COPD. I had never heard that. Chronic obstructive pulmonary disorder. And they showed her, she said, I need supplemental oxygen. So they showed her at home sitting at her desk writing with the oxygen on. I had never seen that. No details have ever really been given of her death. Of what she specifically died from. I have some insight because of people that I know. You know, there's a reason why she wore those glasses and stuff. There's a reason why Bill Cosby wears those dark glasses too. That has never really surfaced. But at any rate, Cicely Tyson tells this story of how she was doing a play in New York shortly before Maya's death in 2014. So this was 2014 when Cicely was in this play in New York. And she said to Maya, you know, I know you're not well and it's okay. Don't feel like you have to come see me in this play. And Cicely said she got off the stage one night and she was told by someone who knocked on her dressing room door and said, you have a guest. And she said, okay. So she went out and she had to climb the steps to get to wherever this guest was. And she said she got to the bottom of the steps and looked up. And then when she's telling this story, Cicely starts crying. Tears start coming out of her eyes. And she said, I looked up and it was Maya. You know, on her last, and she died like right after that. And she's like, on her last legs, that woman braved the night with all the assistance and attendance and all the, you know, ambulatory care that it takes to get somebody from a brownstone in Harlem to a theater on Broadway to come see her sister, her lifelong sister. She came and sat at the top of that steps and watched that play. And that just moved me to tears that they all knew each other, that Maya and Malcolm and Medgar and Martin, they all came up through this. Abby Lincoln, all of them were in this piece together. So when we talk about ancestors, that's who we're talking about. Not just your blood ancestors, but the brothers and sisters who put their lives and their talent and their spirit and their bodies on the line to give us hope.
That's right.
And to give us a life we now enjoy.
They are our ancestors. And when you hit those stories, even with your own parents in the documentary, to find out they were all part of the struggle, it was one unified body. We are in this together. So there was a connection because everyone could only go to one place. They didn't have the luxuries of staying at all these hotels or going to all these restaurants. They went to your mama's house because that's the only place they could go. That's the only place where they felt welcome and felt space so they can have that particular connection. I found out that, you know, my uncle's family was very close friends with Mary McLeod Bethune and had a business with them. We interact in the construct of the struggle is there. It's just a matter of communicating that particular history and supporting that.
Now, Michelle makes an excellent point in your notes here that I want to read. Maybe you were just getting ready to say it. This is a very excellent point and it's very true. The Black creative world was very intimate. It was very intimate because it became a world unto itself because the opportunities to participate on the mainstream stage were quite limited. If you go back to a lot of those earlier films, particularly I'm thinking of Lena Horne, a lot of those films you saw her singing in were completely divorced from what was going on in the film. She would have to film her singing scenes separately. So you never saw her interact with anybody. They would just cut to a scene of her singing Stormy Weather. And then you cut back to what the movie was really all about. So it was very limited access to some of the mainstream artistic opportunities. So what we did, like we always do, necessity is the mother of invention. We created our own circles and traveled within those circles. So in that context, it does make sense that a lot of these people know each other. If you think about the people that were in the room and at the program when the National Museum of African American History and Culture kicked off that weekend, all the luminaries, a lot of them kind of do know each other. The circle is a lot bigger these days, but they're all sort of moving in the same sphere many times. So it's just fascinating to me, the ones that know each other and how those friendships form that most of us would never even know about or think about. Find yourself to love.